If you're up this time of day and you see a live video, you know what that means. It is preview day. It's my favorite day because we got the hall set up all behind us. It's open to the public. If you haven't ever been to a preview day, please come. It's open to the public. You get to touch, inspect, look at any of the items that we have set up in the hall. Even if you're not buying anything, we don't care. Just come. It's the best gun show you've never been to. It's an absolute blast. It's an absolute education. So come. But if you can't, obviously the full catalog is still on rockislandauction.com. Tell you what, if you can't come, let's take a little walk through. It's just an incredible sale. There's just absolute bangers of collector firearms in this sale. So enough with that. Let's just flip the camera around and get started, shall we? So this is, if you walk in over through that, this is what you see when you first walk in, and it's some pretty incredible Colts. Here's one we've done some videos on, a 1860 that's just about pristine with the Thor conversion. It's hard to know like what to stop on, because there's so many items in this sale, like gorgeous Helfrich engraved Colt single actions, like near mint. Or you could go on three digit 1911s, or you could go on the 1905 prototype, you know, and talk about your 1911 trials. Or you could go to Salvatore Dormus, some of these early rare experimental early 20th century pistols, and you name it. Or we could talk about like the 20 class 3 items that are in the sale. Some of the usual unusual birds. Oh, especially you. How are you? Well, my deuce is all dressed up. And some of these, and of course, I show these class threes. I show all these class threes. Everything in this cabinet is also machine guns. And these are just the ones that are gonna be sold on day one. And if we get closer, you see it's not just machine gun NFA items. There's also, you know, well rods. I don't even know where to start. MG34, street sweepers, it's suppressors, H&Ks, you name it, it's the works. There's so much to show you. I won't stop, I can't. But a gorgeous 73. How about an iron frame Henry? Now, we made a video, you'll see it, just talking about all like the grails in the video. And that is one of them. Let's see, get my finger out of the shot. How about that? Are we on? All right. But how about the preview hall as a whole? That is nice. Obviously, there's a few cannons in the sale, including a pretty rare brass Confederate cannon. It's out in the auction lobby. We're showcasing that one because it is about as rare as hen's teeth. And how about two, you know, speaking of grills, how about a Colt Walker? This one also with some Confederate history. Sorry from the glare on the glass. It's just the way it's going to be for a live video, I'm afraid, my friends. But, you know, when you have a Colt inside of all, you better follow it up with a number 5 Texas Patterson on the other. And it is cased. It is accessoried. It's a peach. Of course, all the handgun racks that we won't have time for, but let's get to one of the stars of the show, shall we? Boy, if you haven't seen our video yet on the war pistols of Alexander Hamilton, if you haven't seen some of the coverage that these guns have been getting, well, here's your chance. Now, these have the highest estimate of any firearm we've ever offered. They have the potential to set a world record. They also come with his epaulettes that he wore while he was a colonel. These came out of the Hamilton family in the early 1940s, and they are incredible pieces of American history. You can see the AH, if I can get it to focus on there, the AH monogram on the back there. We're gonna sell those. That's lot 125. So we're gonna sell those Friday morning, like within the first 2 hours, those are gonna sell, and that should be pretty exciting. There we go, some beautiful wheel lock. Catch the morning sun. I tell you what the morning sun is good for. Check out that relief engraving on top of the barrel. Like, you know, the insets usually get people's attention, but here in the sun, in the early morning sun, we can really catch those, that relief engraving. That's something special. I wonder if you like Soviet flamethrowers. There's those too. Now on the other side of Alexander Hamilton, boy, I mean, the sign says it all. Ulrich double signed this Winchester 1873, gave it the deluxe treatment. This would have been exhibited at the World's Fair, the Centennial Exposition in Philadelphia that year. What a treat. There's some videos on that guy too, some real deep dives into that history of the Centennial Exposition. So if you haven't seen those, I would encourage you to check those out. There's some more unusual pistols over here. We won't often look in the handgun cases, but man, when you get the chance to see a Ryger, you take it. When you get the chance to see an Adler Waffenwerke, you take it. Sorry guys, I know that glass is reflecting. I wish it wasn't the case. And everything you just saw is on day one. So if you haven't heard the spiel before, everything from basically this wall and over to there, everything there is going to be sold on day one. That's just Friday. That's all we've walked through so far. Day two, Saturday, will be, oh, FBI, you're so whimsical. Glad to have you here. Saturday will be from here all the way over. Oh, sorry, Bat Masterson. It's about that white pole you can kind of see sticking out there. That'll be everything on day two. And then, hello, Bat. And then everything on day three, we have everything that's left from there to, again, to about the white pole. So let's take a look around day two. And since, oh, Bat, he's always trying to be in these videos. Oh, we might as well show his gun. It's a beautiful little nickel Colt single action with the higher sight, as requested by Bat Masterson in a letter to Colt. The factory letter, which shows shipped to W.B. Masterson on July 5th, 1888. Pretty phenomenal. If you didn't know, there's almost, I think, between 40 and 50 timepieces in this auction. A lot of Rolexes, but there's also some Breitlings, some Tudors, some Omegas. There's some pretty nice stuff. In fact, this, look at the blue on this. It just jumps at me. I'm usually not one for gold on gold, but man, that jumps. And here's, of course, one that should be getting a little bit of attention. It's a Rolex Big Red Daytona. If you're trying to zoom in on that. Daytonas are hot. Daytonas are hot right now. And you know, we've got it with some of these other beautiful pieces. That is actually one of a pair. So here's the second. They come with their case, of course. More timepieces, but I think the favorite part is we have interspersed with these timepieces some really, really beautiful guns. There's a gold inlaid and case hardened Galois in its case, and you can even see the cartridges. You don't get to see those very often. That's how big those are, those little 8mm stubby rounds. Beautiful gold Gustav Jung, Smith & Wesson, and on the next shelf down, three Tiffany & Companies. We have one Smith & Wesson back there. One, obviously, right up here front and center. Pretty unusual. And this guy right here, that's a beautiful, beautiful piece. Just sculpted grips. And so, yeah, watches, Tiffany & Company. So high art, some little gems in other areas. And let's turn around. Well, we're still on day two. Here's one of the featured items, a beautiful Singer M1911A1. Videos on that coming up. Check out some of the more unusual ones, a Mauser prototype 1214. A Skoboa. 1907. Like I said, some of those early pistols, those early semi-autos are in this sale, and they're just endlessly fascinating. Here's one of the big dogs of the auction. We've got a little Type 1 FG42. We've never sold a Type 1 before. All the ones we've sold have been Type 2s with the straight grip. This is that Type 1 with that swept back grip. So in the Type 2s, obviously bring phenomenal money. They sell for right around $300,000. So it'll be exciting to see what the Type 1 brings. Here's some beautiful pistol set by Gastine Renette. A gorgeous sword. We do have a special video on this one from the Battle of Trafalgar, awarded for actions in the Battle of Trafalgar, which is one of like the last great sailed fighting ship naval battles. It's also where Lord Horatio Nelson is fatally wounded. It's just a phenomenal piece of history, and it's beautiful. I mean, are you seeing this gold? Are you seeing the hilt? Like, the sword is one thing, the scabbard is another. You get to that hilt. There's so much symbolism and ancient Greek symbols in there. It's pretty incredible. How about a collier? That one's actually an Italian-made collier, so that's a interesting bird. Let's keep walking. There's no time. No time to stop, except for this. So speaking of Holy Grails, we already went the Singer. We already did the Iron Frame Henry. About a 101,000 Winchester 1873. And the model 1894. More on that, I think, in 2 days. We'll have a little video on that little pair. So subscribe, do your thing, click bells, mash buttons, all that stuff. And you've seen our video on the Ferguson rifle. So if I can come around and actually show you that breech that makes it so famous. There you go. That screw top breech. Pretty innovative for the time. We do have a blog on this Winchester 66. A lot of religious symbols in that one. Kind of funny. Very unusual. More Class 3s. Not only, of course, this whole mountain of Class 3s. That's the best way to have Class 3s, I think, is a mountain of them. Yeah, Dushkas, MG42s, ICM60s. Oh, what else we got over here? I see 1919, 1917s, 30 cals. All sorts of goodies. Oh, yeah, a little Shosha action. Some Hotchkiss babies. It's all good. Here's some more of these Class 3s. There is one special Tommy gun. There's STG-44. But one special Thompson. Oh, my goodness. The Remington Thompson 1923 prototype. It's just about, I mean, we need to know a regular Thompson goes for, you know, about $35,000. And this one's estimate, as you can see, they're poking out 85 to 130. That's a special bear right there. And even when you look at the magazine, for 18 shot cartridges. If you want to know more about that one, that's lot 1549. You can head over to rockislandauction.com, or you can come here and see it yourself. I don't know how many times I'll mention that, you know, this is open to the public. You can come see these yourself. You can see Gatling guns. You can see Hotchkiss revolving, or I'm sorry, Hotchkiss, good sakes, revolving cannons. What was a Hotchkiss revolving cannon? Here I was thinking I outspoke. Look at that, look at the rounds on this guy. Big boy. Oh, the sweet, sweet Gardner gun. About as steampunk as it gets. For those asking, I see here, you know, is a question, is a machine gun a good investment? I mean, obviously I'm a little biased from working here, but I'm also in a really good place to see what the prices have done. And there is a limited supply. There's only a finite supply of machine guns. And with the kind of mountain of legislation around them, I think it would be very difficult to change that legislation. So I don't think you'd have to be worried about them going anywhere, since they are so heavily regulated already. Yeah, machine gun prices are nuts, and like I said, there's only a finite supply. We even have Pat's Place built again. So this is, as you can see, something we built for the John Fox collection. If you think that kind of looks like an old trading post, well, you're correct. It's exactly what it looks like. It's an old trading post. So what happened here, and just a lot of guns from the John Fox collection. If you saw our earlier videos, we've been selling John Fox's items for a couple auctions now, and they're really about, you know, working guns of the old West, specifically Montana and Big Sky country. And so that's a lot of what you'll see here. I mean, there's a lot of guns that show some wear, that show real use, maybe have connections to that Montana area. Very cool. Very cool, authentic items. People say, oh, those are just the junker items. They're not taken care of. No, no, no. These were taken care of. That's why they still exist. These were working guns that people had to take care of. These were their livelihoods. This is how they defended themselves. They kept food on the table. Just very, very cool. Authentic. And of course, you know, it's not just guns. There's old photographs. You saw the bullet boards earlier. Just extremely neat stuff. So let's head out the backside. So we're still on day two. But you know what? Let's start around day three. We'll start it here in the back with another Mountain O machine guns. Here we've got a few more modern deals. We got M1A sitting here at the bottom. It's an unusual. We got a Westinghouse 1918. You can see, you tell right away, you see the cutouts, you know it's for aircraft use. So it's a nice 0815 Maxim. Oh, some Japanese goodies. Vickers. We have some usual ones. There's a nice Valmet from 78. Mm-mm-mm. There are some goodies. Oh. Oh, what's this? Little HK. Little G3. Little H21. Now, I see someone else too ask, you know, is collecting firearms a rich person's hobby? It can be. It certainly can be. Obviously, with the estimate on the Hamilton pistols being, you know, between 1 and 3 million, yeah, you can be really wealthy and get into firearms. You can also not be really wealthy and get into firearms. This is our premier auction. You're looking at the best of the best. This is world-class firearms. This is kind of the top of the collecting hobby. But we also have our sporting and collector auctions, which are a little more, I mean, you still find great collectibles. They might not be as pristine as what you see in our premier auctions. And of course, because of that, you're gonna get it at a much easier to afford price. So we also have our arms and accessories day auctions. There's a deer gun, if you haven't seen one of those before. The arms and accessories day auctions. Those they have almost monthly, so those are another really good chance. If you know your local gun store doesn't have much in it, we do. Here's one I can't pass by without talking about it. This was one that is documented as purchased by the Dalton gang for their Coffeyville raid. It's one of those 10 guns. Very, very cool. We sold another one a couple auctions ago. It went just great, and so we expect similar great things from that one. That said, going back to firearms kind of as a whole, the hobby for collecting firearms is relatively inexpensive. Now, we say that, of course, with a potential multi-million dollar pistol here, but like our video on those pistols says, you know, Mike Trout's rookie card in 2009 sold for $4 million. You have Ferraris going for $40 million at auction, as much as $70 million privately. And so when we're talking about the peak of firearms collecting, and it's between $1 and $3 million, you have a relatively inexpensive hobby compared to some of the modern art, cars, even baseball cards. So is firearms collecting expensive? You know, it can be, but it doesn't have to be. There's a lot of room to play. Great U.S. military stuff. Great U.S. military stuff in this auction. And the last boot, or the last couple cases of Class 3s, a Reisig, a M16, some more HK goodies, some Uzis, some MAC-10, and of course, Thompsons. Love to see them come through. And gang, that's about all of day three, but I'm gonna show you one more item. We'll kind of come flip around. Okay, two. So just a gorgeous piece of work by LD Nimschke.
is at 66. A Winchester revolver, and if you're thinking, well, that seems pretty unusual, you'd be correct. Winchester, with their gentleman's agreement with Colt, didn't make a whole lot of revolvers, but they did make a handful, I think right around a dozen, to take to that Centennial Expedition 1876, and that's where this hails from, as well as that 1866 next to it. That's rare. If you want to see most of those, there's, again, maybe at least two floating around. There may be a few more than that, but most of those are locked up in the Cody Firearms Museum. So really, really neat chance to pick up one of those. And the last pair we'll show you is another one we did a special video on. It's this pair of Remington New Models. These are presented, they are mirror images of each other. These are another work from L.D. Nimshki. These were presented to the Tsar, Alexander II of Russia, when during the Civil War, Russian ships came to American ports. And that was, we were very excited to see that because it meant that maybe France and Britain would think twice before supporting the Confederate cause. So Americans were very elated to see the Russian ships. And these revolvers kind of commemorate the occasion. You'll see naval revolving. You see the American seals on one side, the Russian seal, and the House Romanov is on the other. They are just fantastic. And that's everything, gang. We've walked around the whole preview hall. It only took us about 20 minutes. Of course, that's the quick version. You could spend all day in here. And frankly, we encourage that if you wanted to come and spend all day in here. Because not only is the preview day open to the public, afterwards, we have a little bit of an after party. There's some food. There's some drinks. There's a lot of great people to talk about guns with, especially the guns you saw during the day. We do provide a little bit of subject matter here on preview day. So thanks for watching, everybody. Hope you liked it. RockIslandAuction.com if you're interested in bidding, or if, like I said, if you can't come to preview day, there's still lots of great photos on there. Thanks. I'm glad you woke up. Showed guns with Rock Island Auction Company. Take care, everybody. Till next time, keep your powder dry.